welcome y'all to another edition of Around the Rim. I'm your host, the Dudster, Nestor Dudley. And after the first couple of weekends play, we have one remaining undefeated team. That team is the Pistons. They are here now representing the Pistons. Chuck Washington, Belen Daniel, and Danny Pateau. Gentlemen, welcome to Around the Rim.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Pistons, first place on top of the Heat, 2-0. We were snowed out last Sunday. So if we wasn't snowed out, chances are the Pistons would be 3-0. But Chuck, tell me about this Pistons team. Chuck Washington is a three-year senior on this Pistons squad. Tell me the differences between this Piston team and the two Piston teams the two seasons past. Because as you know, Chuck, your entire career, I predicted the Pistons to go to the madness. And the past 2 years, what's up with you boys that wear black and teal? You just don't want to go to the madness.
I don't know. For the last 2 years, we've always had like a decent squad. Like, we always had a good squad. Like, we had a good point guard. Everybody could work together, but we just couldn't finish our games. Mm-hmm. Like, we'd come off with a strong lead. You know, we'd play hard. Come fourth quarter, it's that fourth quarter pressure. Team just broke down defensively and offensively.
Now, why is that? Why would the team break down like that?
I have no idea. I don't know, because, like, we'd be doing good. Like, I remember one game, we was up by, like, 20 points.
At the half?
Mm-hmm. You know, against the Sonics. And then Pee-wee, Justin Richardson just brought it back, and we lost that game by 2 points.
Matter of fact, that was your season opener last year. Yes, that was your season opener last year.
No.
It wasn't the season opener last year?
That was the middle of the season.
Middle of the season. Okay, yeah. So I thought that happened the season. The Sonics came back on somebody's season opener last year. But we're not talking about last season. We're talking about this season.
Twice.
Yeah.
And Belen came on the scene the past season, and you've won the three-point contest that we have at Madness Weekend. And you also have the single-game record held by three-pointers in a game, 9 three-pointers. The old record was held. The old record was established way back in 1994. I guess that's the Stone Age for you guys. Way back in 1994. By the name of Brian Resendez, representing the Lakers, the team that you just so happened to beat this past weekend. So talk to me. Shooting all those threes, drain them like ice cream. And this team looks better than last year's team. Last year's team looked good. It didn't finish, but last year's team looked good.
Well, I think that when we versus the Lakers, you know, we started out good. You guys kept close in the game, and you guys were missing one of your starters. So at halftime, we kind of acknowledged that we got to start pushing the tempo more and getting more fast breaks.
Yeah, one of the starters that, well, actually, the Lakers were only missing one player that game, and it was Wen Zhu, who is a second-year senior. But you guys played so good, so you guys, chances are you guys could have won that game with Wen being in the house or not. Danny Bitew, second-year player in the Mall Neighborhood Basketball League. But you started your career wearing the Celtics green. How did you end up in the black and teal?
It started off the day of the draft. They called Joe Young, assistant coach of the Celtics, called me. You know, he asked me if I wanted to get traded because last year I asked for a trade.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, hey, if you guys want to give me up, it's fine with me.
Now, why did you ask for a trade last year?
Oh,
and you realize that, well, you realize this now, but I just have to let the viewing audience out there that trades are not the easiest thing that happened in the Mall Neighborhood Basketball League. There's a lot of factors that have to happen. First and most importantly, the player has to want to go, okay? No players are ever just forced to another team if they don't want to go. Then you have to have your present coach wanting to trade you, agreeing to trade you, and then a receiving coach willing to receive that trade. And then, of course, there's compensation, whether it's draft picks or whether it's just a straight-up one-on-one trade. So trades are not an easy thing to do in this Mall Neighborhood Basketball League. But I've never had a player up here, Danny, that have actually asked to be traded, so on the show, rather. So I'm just wondering, like, why would you want to get out of your Celtic contract? Is Magic that much of a taskmaster that you just had to get out of that Emerald contract?
Well, we weren't doing well as a team, and I wasn't planning to come back this season because I was planning to go to another school.
Mm-hmm.
So I wanted to, you know.
Another school, like, outside of Malden? Or
yeah, outside of Malden.
Like, you know, were you planning on moving?
No, just moving to another school.
Oh, okay.
And so I wanted to, you know, my only year playing basketball, I want to play, you know, I want to have a chance to go for the title.
Mm-hmm.
Also, I want to go play with my cousin, so that's one reason I want to go play with the Pistons.
That's right. Belen Daniels, your kinfolk. Mm-hmm. You guys are cousins. Now, you have said that you were concerned about that you were going to go to another school and that you were concerned that you wasn't going to be able to play in the Mall Neighborhood Basketball League this season. Well, I know for a fact that once you start out in the program of the Mall Neighborhood Basketball League, you can finish. So, in other words, your first year of the MNBL, if you live and go to school in Malden, then you can actually move outside of the city like your next couple of years, but you started in Malden because when you move, it's not you moving, it's your parents moving, and we're assuming that you want to be clothed and fed, you're going to go with your parents. You're not leaving your parents, you're going with your parents. So you could have moved, or you could have gone to another school and still played in this league. But you know what? We're glad that you're in Malden, because why should another community benefit from a nice young gentleman like this? He should be staying in Malden. So this Pistons team, let's go down this roster. Chuck Washington, as I said, Steve Sands, three-year man. Kyle Rufo, three-year man. Eddie Pierre, Makende Noel, Belen Daniel, Danny Bitew, Hervé Childs, Ricky McCoy, and Lucas Enjamy. I have to tell you guys, that's a tight squad you have. It really is.
Yeah. It just looks a lot, because we have more players now like that can actually play the game.
Mm-hmm.
Last year, we had a couple kids that didn't really know the game that well. We'd go on the court, mess up.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, for the past few years, we've had a couple kids like that. And now, everybody
all squad. Those kids who messed up, or those kids who didn't understand the game, are they gone now, or are they still on the team?
No, they're gone.
Oh, okay, so they all graduated and or moved away or something like that.
Yeah, so everybody actually has, like, are familiarized with the game.
Mm-hmm.
And we've actually played together before, like at certain points in time, like we all played together. And we all played together, we played well.
Belen, how was that teamwork playing together and being familiar with your teammates?
Well, once you start playing with your teammates, you understand where they're gonna be on the court, how they're gonna cut, and what shots they wanna take. And you're going to feel comfortable passing them the ball because you played with them before.
Mm-hmm. Now, Danny, as we said, you were on the Celtics last year, so this is your first year on the Pistons. And it seems like that you seamlessly have gone into this rotation. So how is that now playing with a different team, different head coach? So that means there's different philosophies involved.
Well, me and Chuck, we played on the 8th grade Fairway team, and we won the championship that year.
Okay, is that a part of the Al-Lock Basketball League?
No, it was within the public schools.
Schools played each other.
Okay, and so what team was that?
For the Fairway school.
Okay, back in the 8th grade.
Yep. Yeah. So me and Chuck played then, and we've always played ball, you know, in our school.
We actually, ever since we actually started playing together on the streets or in the gym, we've actually never lost a game being on the same team.
You've never lost a game?
Never lost a game.
2-on-2, 3-on-3.
Really?
Never. Yeah.
So, well, you know, there has never been a team in the Malden Neighborhood Basketball League to go undefeated. That's certainly a realistic goal. The odds are against you. And that's no disrespect, you know. I mean, you know, the Patriots couldn't do it last year, right? And they're paid professionals. So the odds are against you. But if you never lost a game, do you think you could handle losing if it happens? I mean, it might happen. It might not happen this weekend, but it might happen.
You know, it happens, but it comes down to crunch time during the playoffs, you know? That's when it really counts. This whole season is just practice when it comes down to it.
Mm-hmm. I like that attitude. It really is. The season is practice in the sense of everyone has the goal, and in this league, it's all about the jackets. Finishing in first place is nice, but it's all about the jackets. 2 years are gone. The Kings finished in first place, but they lost to the Celtics in the big dance. So, yeah, the Kings got the trophies, and the trophies are nice, but after a couple of years, the trophies become a paperweight, and this league is all about the jackets. So now, Belen, you have a couple of teammates that have been playing together since 8th grade. Every time they played, whether it's organized or unorganized, they're undefeated. They don't believe in playing 3-on-3? Like, you know, were you not on these teams, or were you on the opposite team getting beat by these guys?
Well, I played with Danny in middle school, 5th and 6th grade.
Oh, okay.
Danny used to always be with Chuck after that in 7th grade, so we always would go to the park and the gym together, play ball.
So you three have had a long history of playing together.
Yeah.
Didn't realize that.
Also,
nice. No wonder why you guys, yes.
Also, Kyle, Hervé, Lucas, and Ricky, we all played basketball with them too in Fairway because they're on a basketball team.
They were actually on the basketball team at Fairway too.
Really?
Yeah.
If myself and Brad with Benton had known this before last week's show, we might have picked a different outcome. Who's going to take the big dance, the whole damn thing? So, Waldo, welcome back, Waldo, from our vacation, from the long season off. Did you hear this, Waldo? We have Waldo now. Would this team classify as ringers because they've been playing together now for 5, 6, 7 years? They classify as ringers. I mean, you and I have never teamed up 2-on-2, have we? Oh no, and we did. We probably lose. Chances are, yeah. We are only slightly older than you guys, so we probably would lose. We look at other teams in the league, and well, you know what? Before we look at the other teams in the league, I want to talk about that Laker game. That Laker game was a high-energy game. It was playoff atmosphere, mm-hmm. and it was only your second game and the Lakers' third game. Why you? It seems like that the entire week leading up to this, it was like, okay, the Lakers and the Pistons, they're going to face off first game. And that gym was packed full of people in the stands. Everyone wanted to see that game.
Top two teams in the league. You know, we're known as
but it's only the second week out of the year.
Exactly. That's
crazy. We played each other twice.
Play each other twice. And this is the first game. Everybody wants to see how it would turn out. You know, it's the top two teams in the league. Who wouldn't want to see those two match up? Like, that's what happened. Everybody showed up. Big crowd. I love it.
Well, Waldo, is it time for the MNBL web? Because I don't...
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay, I'm sorry. Go, ref, go. I pulled a
somebody else that we won't mention.
No, I pulled a somebody else, and his show was LOT. I pulled a Ron Cox, didn't I? So it seemed like... I agree with you. Everybody wanted to see that game, the Pistons up against the Lakers, and that was a high-energy game. And as you guys know, because we talked about it before we went on, that both myself and Waldo said it was going to come down to the Lakers and Pistons. We both had the Lakers coming in first place. We both had the Lakers beating the Pistons. But I said you before we went on, it's not an exact science. It's just a gut reaction. Yeah. But you guys did it the right way because you guys said, Nesta, you didn't pick us. But it was all tongue-in-cheek. It was certainly, you know, you guys certainly wasn't offended by it. But that was a damn good game.
Oh. It really was. It came down to the wire. You guys, you know, Lakers brought it back, you know.
Brought it back close a lot of times.
Yeah, the Pistons just couldn't put them away. There's a couple of times that the Pistons were up on the Lakers by double digits. 11, 12 points, something like that. But couldn't put it away. The Lakers came back on you.
Came out.
You guys came back. You guys got to the foul line a lot. You guys hit your layups. You guys played good defense.
Also, as a team, we're just getting better and better every week, mm-hmm. you know, so we're going to adjust to that. We got to slow down our game at some points in the, you know, during the game.
We're learning our strengths.
We got to learn how to use the clock more, too.
Yeah.
What I noticed, what you guys done in that game, but now my man Waldo is telling me that it's that time for Caught Up in the MNBL web. So what this segment is that I have up until 3 minutes to ask my guests. This point, it's Chuck Washington, Belen Daniel, Danny Bitew, anything I want, and it may or may not have to do with the Malden Neighborhood Basketball League. We're going to be kind on you in this web. Tell me about head coach PC, Paul Conrad. That dude really gets into it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's more defensive organized, like more defensive oriented. Like if we don't get back on defense, he'll get a little mad, like, whose guy is that?
Oh, whose man is that? He's been saying that for years. Whose man is that? That right hand get to shaking.
And that's basically like he's focused on. And he likes to get the ball in the post. He likes to have everybody set up exactly where they're supposed to be.
And Anthony Guerrero, coach, he was on Paul's championship team. And so now you have someone who's close to your age. What does he bring to the table as far as coaching?
I mean, he tells us how it was when he played neighborhood, so he gives us some of the tips and factors that might help us win a game while he's coaching.
Mm-hmm. And now what everybody wants to know is, what in the world does Howard Jones bring to that table? What is what is Howard telling you? All three of them start laughing.
Uncle Phil.
Uncle Phil.
We call him Uncle Phil.
Do you all listen to your old Uncle Phil?
Yeah, we listen to him. Like, some of the stuff he says is good, like, it takes into consideration. Like, he's smart, though.
When he puts in a play, do you actually follow it?
Well, he doesn't really come up with that many plays. It's more like Paul coming up with plays, and then we just follow that.
Okay. Gentlemen, you three are out of the web. See how simple that is? We took care of you. Back here in the studios of Ball and Access Television, I'm your host, the Deadster, Nesta Dudley, along with Piston Representation, Chuck Washington, Belen Daniel, Danny Bitew. And we were talking about the Lakers, that Laker game, right before we went to the web. And what I was about to say was, what I noticed with this Pistons squad is that you all, as a team, love to shoot the threes. Beyond the arc, where everything is three. Your team spreads the floor. So it's going to be hard for teams that traditionally play a 2-3, they're going to have to be forced to play a 3-2. So you're certainly taking the opposition out of their game, okay? When you guys were pulled ahead against the Lakers, double digits, 11, 12 points, as I said before, instead of killing the clock, which I think that you said that the Pistons need to learn, instead of killing the clock, you guys were jacking up those threes. And at this point, you were missing those threes, which led to the Laker comeback. That's dangerous. You could have easily lost that game. And when I say easily, I don't want to make it sound like that the Lakers were that much better than you. I pretty much think that the Lakers and the Pistons are an even team. It's just two different styles, two different philosophies of how to play the game of basketball. But yeah, do you think those, if you had it to, of course you won the game, but do you think, are you guys going to continue to jack up threes? Every coach in the MNBL hates those threes, including Paul Conrad. There's a couple of times you guys jacked up threes. Paul said no until it went in.
Yeah. Well, we have a lot.
You wouldn't know anything about threes, so I guess these are the
issues.
Well, we got a few people on the team that can shoot some threes.
Yeah, Lucas and Jamaica shoot threes.
Lucas can shoot. Belen and I can shoot. But like you said, there's moments that we need to like have some discipline and need to know when to shoot. And that's some stuff that we need to adjust during the season.
Because killing the clock, basketball is a timed game, so you have a nice, comfortable lead. You know, you just want to win this game. Yeah. Doesn't matter if you win this game by one. Doesn't matter if you win this game by 31. Long as you win this doggone game. And Chuck Washington, having you on this show, if I didn't ask you this one question, I would not be doing my journalistic duties, and Go Ref Go would not appreciate this, but I have stats from the past couple of seasons, Chuck, and I think you know where I'm going with this, okay?
Yeah.
In 2007, your rookie year, Chuck, you were the dirtiest dozen of them all. You had 49 fouls.
I know I recognize that name.
Yes, he's the dirtiest dozen of them all. 49 of them, baby. Last year, I think you calmed down. I think you settled in last year. You ended up second with 44. And the game against the Lakers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 equals bye-bye. You fouled out of that game, too. What's up? You only have 12 more games left in your career. I don't want to see you not finishing a few of those games.
I don't know. Like, some of the fouls that the refs called, in my opinion, I think kind of
ridiculous.
Because
you are entitled to your opinion, okay?
In my opinion, I think kind of ridiculous because I set up, take a charge. I have my hands in the air a couple times. I'm not going to lie, maybe the first two fouls. But
the first two in your career when you were a sophomore, or the first two last weekend?
The first two last weekend. But the last three, like, I just thought that was ridiculous. And I got mad. After I got fouled out, I was mad. Like I didn't think that I deserved those fouls.
Yes, Goreko?
Can I comment on that?
Oh, you can absolutely comment. Goreko, you at that game.
There are three sides to every call.
Mm-hmm.
The offensive, the defensive, and what the refs saw. There's only one side that matters, though.
It's what the ref saw. Correct?
That's right.
It's true, true.
The ref saw you foul five times.
That's what they saw. That's what they saw. Like, I can't do nothing about it now. Mm-hmm. It's just next game.
Couldn't do nothing about it then, either.
But you know, Chuck, your job is down low in the paint doing work, and you've spent a career doing that. And you have help down there with Sands and Rufo. So, you know, you have weapons. You have outside shooting. I mean, last year you only had one pure outside shooter. Now it seems like you got a couple of more.
Yeah.
So now how does that change? Or how, you know, tell me what you feel about that. You know, the differences between you have a legitimate outside game now, Piston team-wise, as opposed to last couple of years.
Well, I'm a lot more comfortable now. Like, if they're jacking up threes, I have some faith in them that they'll make it in.
Some faith in them.
Because some threes get me real nervous. Uh-huh. Like, when the game's close, jacking up threes, we don't need them. We just need to get the ball down low.
Mm-hmm.
I won't say to me, to anybody that's down low, uh-huh, in that position.
Because basketball, a lot of coaches believe, should be played inside out.
Yeah.
Inside and first.
But with this, I like them shooting threes because they're good at it. They're good at what they do.
Mm-hmm.
And if it brings the defense out, it leaves the inside more vulnerable. So if they bring the defense out, they can get the ball down low, we're going to score.
Well, we certainly know how good these guys are shooting threes. And Lucas hit a three the other day. Belen Daniels, the reigning three-point shot champion. And with Danny Bitew on your team, you've never lost a game in your life. So these boys are doing what they're supposed to be doing.
Exactly.
Hitting those threes.
I feel comfortable with it.
You already said you had something.
I have something because sometimes I get nervous jacking up threes because sometimes they'll be a little bit too deep and I'll be like, is that going to go in?
Uh-huh.
I don't know. And then, like, there's only two of us down there, like, maybe like two or three of us down there getting bored or something. So. Mm-hmm.
Well, my main man Wallace Wickwitz is telling me it's that time to go into the roll-ins. So we're going to go into this week's roll-ins. I don't have actual games, but I do have scores from last Saturday, January 10th. First game, Pistons-Lakers. We were just talking about this. Pistons 53, Lakers 52. Bell and Dan led all scores with 21 points. Big Billy Hurley, high man for the Lakers, 16 points. The Pistons improved to 2-0. The Lakers dropped to 2-1. Next game, Kings Bullets. 11 points better. The Bullets were the Kings, 51-40. Taquan Wass, high man for the Kings, 15 points. Jerome D led all scores with 16 points. The Bullets improved to 2-1. The Kings dropped to 0-2. Third and final game of the weekend, because we got snowed out Sunday. Hawks versus Celtics. Hawks 38, Celtics 49. Jace Carl, high man for the Hawks, 9 points. White led all scores with 14 points. The Celtics improved to 1-1, and the Hawks dropped to 0-2. Again, Sunday snowed out, so that's what happened this past week. So now it's on to the weekly Around the Rim Awards. So let's kick it! Player of the Week? Player of the Week? At least go to a two-shot. I can't remember who the Player of the Week was. Player of the Week? Waldo, go in there and kick him.
It's lost.
It's not lost. It's in there. Well, until they find a Player of the Week and all that stuff, he said, Chuck Washington says that he has some faith.
We got it.
You got it? Player of the Week, Belen Daniels. See, brother, we took care of you. Belen Daniels, Player of the Week of the Pistons. Coach of the Week, Paul Conrad of those same Pistons. Team of the Week, you have to get it to the Pistons. They are on top of the league, on top, looking down. And Woo of the Week, it ain't a Pistons sweep. Look at this. Woo of the Week is Jerome D. Jerome Dean of the Bullets. Woo of the Week. Jerome Dean carrying that Bullet squad. Bullets improving to 2-1. Psyching out these three Pistons representation because they thought it was going to be a Pistons sweep. This woo is for you. Woo! Now on to the official stats. Remember, I don't care what you see. If it doesn't match this, it just ain't official. The Pistons on top of the land right now. 2-0, followed by the Lakers, Bullets, Sonics, Sixers. Both teams are 1-1, along with the Celtics, Hawks, and the Kings. That's how it is thus far, the first couple of weekends in this league. I didn't say Dirty Dozen, because that's last year's Dirty Dozen. And you see, Chuck
that's
Washington.
That's my fault.
I know it's your fault. It ain't my fault.
You meant it's your fault, because you mentioned that you got the dirtiest.
Next week's games. Those I just cut you off real quick. Go, ref, go. Next week's games.
I was stalling for a reason.
You gonna go kick him, Waldo? Okay, well, next week's game, Saturday, January. You know what? This is the beauty of live television. I still have the best darn crew and television. And my philosophy. If it isn't live, it just doesn't count. Saturday, January 17th, the first game's the Kings, the Celtics, the second game, the Hawks, the Bullets, the third game, the Pistons versus the Sonics, and that third game, the Pistons are going for the hat trick. Can they start the season 3-0? Sunday's game, first game Lakers-Sixers, second game Celtics-Sonics, third game Pistons-Kings, and can the champs catch up in the standings? So, go ref, go. How much time we have left in the show? Oh, we got plenty of time. So, where to read them? Around the Rim. Every Thursday live, 7:30 on Channel 3 and Channel 28, if you have Verizon. It replays every Friday night, Around the Rim does at 10 in the p.m., and replays every Saturday afternoon at 2 o'clock and Sunday 7 p.m. both on channels 3 and channels 28. When to watch them? Each Monday through Wednesday you can watch the games 3 o'clock on channel 15 and channel 24 if you have Verizon. The game of the week is every Friday night 7 p.m. on channels 15 and 24. And the game of the week also repeats every Saturday and Sunday 7 p.m. And the game of the week this past week, Lakers versus Sonics, January 3rd. Where to read them? Each week in the Marlin Evening News. And if you're too cheap to spend the 50 cent, that's right, gentlemen, I did say 50 cent, You can go to the official website of the Mall Neighborhood Basketball League, mnbl19.tripod.com, or you can go to the official online home of this show, Around the Rim, atrlive.com. So, Waldo, how much time do we have? We have less than 3 minutes. So we didn't even talk about your opponent this weekend. And opponent this weekend, you are playing the Sonics. Sonics 1-1, they lost their season opener. But they did win their second game. And now that you guys are undefeated, you guys collectively have targets on your back. A team wants to be the first team to take you guys down.
It's not going to be easy.
This makes it more fun for us.
There you go. There you go. And you guys had practice Tuesday night, so did you guys work on killing that clock?
Definitely.
Any last things you guys want to say these last couple of minutes? Any shout out to?
Oh, yeah.
No one even said hi, Mom, once.
Hello, Mother. How you doing, Mom?
Yeah. Kyle Rufo, this is for you.
Darnell Bailey, Billy Hurley. I'm sorry I had to do that to you last week, you know?
Your turn.
Want to shout out to everybody. Hi, Mom. You know I love you. And hope we win the championship this year.
And you know what? I thank you. I didn't mean to cut you off. You want to say something?
Villains, we out here. We out here. Villains, we out here.
This is a nice, fun show. I want to thank you guys for coming here. Chuck Washington.
Thank you for having us.
Daniel. Yep. Danny Bateau. And I wish you guys much success this year, and you know, who knows, the Black and Teal are definitely for real, and they could take home this championship in the 20-09 season. Until next week, I just want to say, buenas noches, hoochas cooches, I came in peace, I leave with love, this is for the red, the black, and the green, and I'll be seeing youths at the games.
They're playing basketball, we love that basketball, they're playing
Malone. I like slam dunks, taking it to the hoop. My favorite play is the alley-oop. I like the pick and roll, I like the give and go, cause it's basketball, but Mr. Curtis blow. Earl the Pearl and Will Bingo and Jerry West play basketball.